Give a little brief background. I've been in medicine for 22 or 23 years. And there are different things that got me into integrative and functional medicine. One was chronic Lyme disease, and the other was, on a more personal note, with a family member who had some issues that needed an alternative approach. So the presentation today will discuss fatigue. And part of the goal is to differentiate between the traditional medical approach to fatigue and the functional medicine approach to fatigue. In addition, I will try to differentiate between those who meet criteria for ME/CFS and those who would have chronic fatigue but would not necessarily meet criteria. So we will start, after a brief introduction of functional medicine, with several case studies. And it's important to note that the case studies we're going to start with they're very common scenarios, but they're not people that would meet criteria for ME/CFS. But I think the cases will be very useful to introduce the functional medicine principles. So functional medicine is an individualized, patient-centered, science-based approach that empowers the patients and practitioners to work collaboratively to address the underlying causes of disease and promote wellness. One way to think that I would think about functional medicine is trying to take the best of the naturopathic principles that tend to be holistic and collaborative, but also the science and evidence-based concepts from traditional medicine. So as much as I try in my career and in my daily medical life to not create a adversarial us versus them relationship, it can be somewhat challenging because the two paradigms and the two approaches can be very different. So allopathic medicine has made tremendous strides and does some things very, very well, but it tends to be fragmented, it tends to be hyper-specialized. And the way I was trained back in the 90s and the way students are still trained today, most of the time is to make a diagnosis and to make a diagnosis that is managed with pharmaceuticals. It's surprising to many patients that physicians and nurse practitioners don't have a lot of training to try to understand the root causes of those conditions that have been diagnosed. So we're not going to get too much into statistics, but I think there's benefit of giving some context and perspective. As everyone in the group knows, I'm sure that ME/CFS and people that meet criteria for chronic fatigue syndrome is a large group that is increasing over time and is almost certainly underestimated. It would depend on what criteria would be used, but I think one of the major benefits is that criteria have been established for ME/CFS. It's on a big scope. But then in the bottom of the screen, you know, it reflects how common chronic fatigue is in our world. Certainly one of the most common presenting complaints to a primary care office. So the first case that I'm going to review is a 40-year-old male. Now, all three of these cases are real cases, and I chose them, as I said before, because I think they show the functional medicine approach, and I think they show well the contrast between traditional and functional medicine. They're all based on real patients I've seen over the years, and these are not rare, isolated scenarios. These are incredibly common scenarios of the three cases I will present. So the 40-year-old male comes in for evaluation with a long list of issues and complaints to be covered in the 15-minute primary care slot. So I used to work in a practice. I was a medical director And my patient panel got up to over 3,300 patients. And it was during this time when I became interested in chronic complex cases and mystery illness cases and tick-borne disease and chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia. And so there was a fundamental incompatibility with me being able to give people proper attention into this slot. So that's why I included that element. So what he reported in this visit from just over 10 years ago was anxiety and hypertension, insomnia, regular heart palpitations, constipation, muscle cramps, and fatigue. Now, as some of you know, and many of you don't know, in the medical jargon, there are certain terms that are used. And for most of my medical career, the term essential hypertension would be used. Essential in this case means not only that there's no appreciation of the underlying root causes, but that there will also be only minimal attempt to understand why a person developed hypertension. The way I was trained back in medical school in the 90s is if somebody came in and had high blood pressure on multiple occasions, we would check them for chronic kidney disease, we would check them for elevated hemoglobin counts. And then if those two basic tests were negative, we would diagnose them with essential hypertension and start them on medication for life. There's always more to that story. Over the prior few months, before he had come into this visit with me, he had seen a psychologist who diagnosed generalized anxiety disorder. He was started on Celexa, SSRI medication, originally developed for as an antidepressant, but as most of you probably know, this group is used for chronic anxiety. Put on trazodone so he could sleep. He also saw a cardiologist who did a fairly standard workup of somebody with recurrent palpitations, heart monitor, echocardiogram, and started a beta blocker. This medication, as with many medications, has side effects, and fatigue being among the most common. So this person was trying to live a healthy life, and the beta blocker fatigue made it more difficult for him to exercise. He had seen a gastroenterologist who diagnosed constipation predominant irritable bowel syndrome and recommended daily Miralax. I would say irritable bowel syndrome is the poster child of functional medicine, of what I used to refer to as a pseudo-diagnosis, but I think some people take that as being a disrespectful to them. Whenever I would use that term in the past, I never meant that the person didn't have real chronic issues. I just meant that irritable bowel syndrome was really not much of an answer. In the overall medical world, it basically means that the person doesn't have any serious underlying causes, which is incredibly important, but that there will be no further investigations in terms of why they have gastrointestinal issues. So he was put on a daily laxative. His regular primary did some blood work and then recommended hydration for muscle cramps. My estimate for this period of time of medical care was somewhere up over 2,500, but that's only for the consultations and tests that were being done during this period. It doesn't even include what the costs would be over time for medications or the other costs to his health and well-being. So at that time, from a functional medicine perspective, this is early on in my functional medicine career. The overwhelming likelihood was that certain factors like stress, alcohol, exercise over time had depleted his minerals, different minerals, and that those deficiencies and imbalances were the primary cause for most or all of his health problems. Now, of course, I've learned many, many times in my medical career to be very careful with planting a flag in the ground and declaring victory. But at that time, I thought there was a very high likelihood that this was the cause. One of the most important principles. So one of the most important things that I've learned beyond my medical training was the importance of magnesium, potassium, and minerals, and like nutrition and leaky gut and gut health and some things that really aren't covered in medical education. But probably the number one reason why these issues get no attention in medicine is because 99% of medical professionals don't know that if you check blood levels of magnesium and potassium, et cetera, that they do not tell you whether the person has deficiency. So a person can have chronic progressive deficiency for 5 years or 10 years or more, and the body, through its homeostatic mechanisms, will maintain blood levels in a very tight range. So I started him on a good form of magnesium. There are many forms of magnesium, but magnesium glycinate is particularly good for anxiety and sleep, in my experience. He started 2 magnesium capsules and one of my all-time favorites, which is concentrated mineral tablets, because they have a very good broad group of minerals and very inexpensive, you know, $12 or $15 typically for a bottle. We have one in the fridge right now. So the total estimated expense for this approach was $40. Within a couple of weeks, his cramps and palpitations resolved and his sleep was improving and he was able to stop the trazodone. Within a month, his bowels were soft and regular and he stopped the Miralax. Within a few months, his blood pressure gradually improved and normalized, and he was able to get off the beta blocker. He did stay on Celexa. So one of the most important principles of integrative medicine from my perspective is to not be dogmatic. I certainly see people that only believe in the traditional pharmaceutical approach, and I see people that only believe in the natural approach, and they would never take a pharmaceutical. And my goal is to work with any or all of them. And the Celexa helped him. And so he wanted to stay on the medication, no problem. Okay. Case number 2, another very common scenario. 45-year-old woman comes in with fatigue, brain fog, depressed mood, unexplained constipation, and difficulty losing weight. She had a very typical set of labs done, which probably most primary care providers would do this almost identical set of tests. And 99% of the time, maybe not quite that much, but 95% plus, all of these labs would be normal. So more and more these days, and we see that people are taking more control of their own health and they're doing more reading and more research. So she wondered if maybe she had a thyroid condition, but she was told, no, I'm sorry. I don't care what you read on the internet. I don't care what your friends have told you. You do not have a thyroid condition because the basic thyroid test, TSH, was normal. So eventually she demanded to see an endocrinologist who graciously repeated the TSH, and most endocrinologists will do one extra blood test, which is the T4 level. They were normal. And she was told that she potentially would meet criteria for chronic fatigue syndrome, but there was really no treatment. And she should go out and exercise, which of course this is difficult to do when you're feeling exhausted. So the functional provider, which is me, I'm not sure why I word it that way, but I ordered some other labs, which is almost always the case with a functional medicine person. I mean, they almost 100% of the time, we would do other tests that haven't been done. So it was found that she had positive Hashimoto's markers, and her active thyroid hormone level, which is free T3, was low. So this is a scenario I've seen so many times over the last 10 years. You know, I wish I could go back in time and keep a spreadsheet with all of these different scenarios so I could keep track, but so the goal, of course, in functional medicine is to try to figure out why she would have a low T3. I mean, we can't go through those. That's a totally different subject matter that we couldn't cover. But So there are many reasons, long list of reasons why somebody would have a thyroid problems. Many reasons why people don't convert T4 to the active T3. In this case, she had Hashimoto's. Most doctors and endocrinologists either never check for Hashimoto's or they'll check it one time and then never check it again because to them, it doesn't alter the management. To a functional medicine person, it would be very different. So one of the most important questions for me early on in someone who has a thyroid condition is whether they have Hashimoto's, because that tends to split our approach a bit. So there are many root causes and contributors to Hashimoto's: leaky gut, non-celiac gluten sensitivity, Epstein-Barr virus, oxalates, et cetera. I would say just as one of the many things I've learned is the number one variable in reversing Hashimoto's, in my experience, is the person avoiding gluten. Again, I wish I was keeping track of it, but I'm pretty sure that of the roughly, let's say 25-ish women who have had their Hashimoto's reversed, all of them, or almost all of them, had to give up gluten to achieve that. And no patient I've seen that's not given up gluten has been able to reverse their Hashimoto's. Again, I don't know that this is literally true, but it's pretty close. So as is often the case, not only is the assessment is different and the testing is different in the functional world, but the treatment is often different. So I found over the years that name brand Levoxyl, instead of the generic levothyroxine, can be more effective. I actually learned that from one of my patients, saw a different functional person, and that was what they did. And I learned that a couple of years ago. So, and it's generally covered by insurance, which is also a shocker, but so name brand Levoxyl and liothyronine, which is T3, worked very well for her. Her fatigue and brain fog got better. And again, this is a very common situation. The third one was a very dramatic case from just over a year ago. My practice is embedded in a larger primary care practice, so I'm sort of the oddball, you know, doing things on my own. And occasionally the other practitioners will send somebody to me, or the person will end up on my schedule if I have openings. 35-year-old, had been in the hospital a couple of times for pulmonary symptoms, cough, shortness of breath, phlegm. She saw a very good pulmonologist, very good infectious disease specialist. Everyone was befuddled. She actually was in the intensive care unit during one of these admissions. When I saw her, she still was very sick. She had cough and breathing, and she was exhausted and brain fog and constipation and sinus issues. And in my review of systems is different now than it used to be. So I'll often ask questions that I would never have thought to answer back in the day, but, okay. So again, my initial impression, which is sometimes right and sometimes not right, this all takes a healthy dose of humility on a regular basis. The most likely explanation, because she was on antibiotics and because she was on steroids, was that she had systemic fungal overgrowth. Now, in this situation, it probably involved her gut, her lung, and her sinuses. I would say for people with systemic fungal overgrowth, lung involvement is fairly uncommon. So that was a relatively unique element for this young woman. So we did a fairly standard approach that probably most naturopathic integrative functional providers would do, at least in terms of the diet, you know, cut back on sugar and foods that turn into sugar. There's a probiotic that's gaining popularity every year that many of you have probably heard of, which is Saccharomyces boulardii, which has healthy yeast as opposed to healthy bacteria. There's a name brand Flora Store, but there are many other brands out there. I put her on oral antifungal fluconazole. In my practice, I'm always trying to decide between the prescription options and the herbal options. And again, I resist any kind of dogmatic approach. I'm trying to learn from everybody I can. I'm trying to learn as much as I can with as much depth. And I'm willing to use any and all options available as long as they're safe and reasonably priced and effective. So again, I alluded to this earlier, but you know, there really needs to be more collaboration between the worlds. Sometimes it feels like us versus them, but we really need, I mean, sometimes I'll say to my patients, I mean, how many smart, dedicated people are there in the field of medicine? I mean, it's, we have all of these tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people. We really, really need to harness the dedication, the intellect and the background and the teaching and training of all of these people, or as well, not all, but as much as we can to make the most progress on things like ME/CFS and fibromyalgia. So, you know, I've been teaching students for a long, long time, and it's frustrating, but I really do not see much collaboration. The worlds are still apart and seemingly growing farther apart in most situations. I give a few examples. Why won't they order the active T3 level? I've actually asked a few of them. They either didn't answer me or gave me some unsatisfying answer that made no sense to me, but I don't understand, if you were an endocrinologist, why you wouldn't want to know the active level of thyroid hormone. It seems very obvious, very self-evident. The insurances cover it. I think what would happen if the endocrinologist started ordering free T3 levels, they would be stunned because 20 to 30 to 40% of their patients might be on the low side and undermanaged. Another one that just blows my mind, and I just can't, like a seed that's stuck in my gum, I just can't understand. If it's well accepted that antibiotics and steroids can cause thrush or can cause a vaginal yeast infection, why in the world couldn't it cause fungal overgrowth in other areas of the body, especially the GI tract, which would seemingly be the most vulnerable area? But nobody in the traditional medical world ever in my 20 something years of medicine has taken any interest in this at all. And I could, these examples I'm putting up are just some of the more common ones. I could probably spend an hour on this kind of thing. Another one, which sounds like for the, you know, the people that are here, tick-borne disease, chronic Lyme disease, very complex, very controversial subject matter that I've been in the middle of for 20 years. People will say they'll check antibodies for Borrelia burgdorferi and say, well, we ruled out Lyme disease. Well, it doesn't make any sense at all. It's actually to the point of absurdity. There are, by my counts, and people in the audience may have some up-to-date numbers, but you know, there are 10, 12, 13 different Borrelia species, 20 plus Bartonella species, 15, 20 plus Babesia species, Ehrlichia, Anaplasma, different viruses you can get from a tick. So how could you possibly do this very basic ELISA test for Borrelia burgdorferi and then call it a day and move on? I think it just makes life much easier for the practitioner to say, well, we ruled out this and we ruled out that, and you know, but people need help. So that's just not good enough. So very important for me in my medical career, again, this is an element of humility. Like, we all in the medical world need to be very open and upfront about what we know, what we don't know, what we understand, what we don't understand. And when there are scenarios where we're wrong or we look at things the wrong way, I don't think it's that much to ask. We have, like any of us in any realm of our life, we have to be willing to accept new ideas. So when I got into functional medicine, whatever it was, like 10 or 11 years ago, I remember I was making a lot of effort to understand the root causes, and the patient came in and said, "Oh, how long have you been doing functional medicine?" And I said, "What's functional medicine?" So I had never heard the term back then. I didn't know what it was. So I went home that night and looked it up, and I said, "That's exactly what I want to do." But when I get into functional medicine, I actually, for many years, I figured, okay, well, people who have chronic fatigue, people who have chronic exhaustion, people that are struggling, people that are frustrated, they have brain fog, they have, you know, depressed mood for good reason, for many different reasons. The people in this group, if they go through a functional, integrated, naturopathic workup, that we should be able to understand what is the root cause. Like I used to say to people, well, of 100 people that meet criteria for chronic fatigue syndrome, my guess is that 10% of them have a thyroid problem, 5% of them have low thyroid, 20% of them have chronic tick-borne disease, 20% have mold toxin illness, you know, some of them have seen bars, some of them have heavy metal toxicity, many of them have combinations. But I've had to take a step back and see that the ME/CFS group seems to be a fundamentally different one. And it, so I've had to come around and say through experience that I've helped a lot of people who had chronic fatigue, and I've helped a lot of people figure out their root causes. But of course, like I can only assume, like most practitioners, I have people that don't respond as well. And almost all of those people would fall under the ME/CFS fibromyalgia category. So the next couple slides, it's a lot of text. I have a friend of mine who looked at I asked him to look through the slides and say, "Tell me what you think." And he said, "What are you doing at the end? You have all this jargon and information. These, you know, I don't care how smart the people are, you're just going to overwhelm them." So part of the reason why I left all of this text and jargon is so it can be a reference point. For those of you who are interested, you can take the time to look at this information, read it through yourself, do some searches on some of the researchers that I'm going to discuss. So long haul COVID, many or all of you have heard of this phenomenon, and there's a lot of hope out there, including from me, that these researchers around the world that have become focused on long haul COVID are going to understand some very important root causes that are relevant to ME/CFS. Whether these scenarios are overlap completely remains to be seen, but it's fascinating to me to see what they're emphasizing, what they're pursuing. So long haul COVID patients, which is an estimate of about 30%. There's a wide estimate of who meets criteria for long haul COVID. Same way there always would be a range for ME/CFS and other diagnoses. But fatigue, cognitive impairment, muscle pain, joint pain, shortness of breath, heart palpitations, sleep difficulties. I mean, it really sounds not as much autonomic dysfunction by my understanding, but it really sounds like there's a lot of overlap. Researchers have focused on many potential contributors, and even so, being in medicine for as long as I have and being in the chronic complex mystery illness cases for as long as I have, the researchers are pursuing so many areas that the people in the functional world and similar have been pursuing as well. So the question is it a chronic infection? Is it that the virus puts stress on the body, and chronic viruses like Epstein-Barr reactivate? Is it that the COVID virus, COVID-19 virus, triggers an autoimmune response? Was it all of these things? How do we compare it from person to person? So these are not new ideas, but probably the most important development that it's not unique, but that stands out is the idea of a virus triggering an immune inflammatory response, causing protein and sludge and deposition in the arterial system with microclots that then deprives the cells and tissue of the body with blood, oxygen, and nutrients. So this is a major focus. Again, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I have a blog that I'm almost done with that really explores some of these ideas and some of these root causes. And the long-haul COVID research not only could help us understand ME/CFS and fibromyalgia, but potentially, because amyloid's involved, potentially Alzheimer's, other inflammatory processes, other autoimmune conditions. I mean, it's the sky's the limit. So one of the most important researchers is a woman named Ressia Pretorius out of South Africa. I'm fascinated. I'm actually connected with her through LinkedIn, which is like, for me, like she's like a celebrity to me because of the work that she and her group are doing. So the fact that she sends a reply to me in LinkedIn is like, you know, major coup. But so it's, and I'd love to know how they chose their regimens. But anyway, her regimen is aspirin, which is a platelet agent because platelet aggregation is part of this process in the arterial system, Plavix, which is a prescription platelet agent, and apixaban, which is a new blood thinner. Many of you probably know that everyone used to use Coumadin, and now there's these new novel agents, and apixaban is one of them. So however they did it, their team, this is what they chose. And within a month, the long-haul COVID reports 90% improvement. Now, these things have to be corroborated, reinforced, repeated. So another important group is Bruce Patterson. He's been a researcher in the immunology, virology world for, I think, 25, 30 years. He doesn't look that old, but he must be taking good care of himself because I think I've seen him interviewed and he's been doing this work since early HIV days, by my understanding. So one thing that he and his group are doing is they have this cytokine profile called InCell-DX. It looks for different immune markers. Again, modest, it's a lot of medical jargon. It gets very, very technical. I saw him interviewed and I was, you know, my head was spinning for half of it, but to try to identify reliably who meets criteria for long-haul COVID, same way researchers have worked very hard over the last 5 or 10 years to find the most common markers for people with ME/CFS. And I think part of the benefit of that is to prove to the small group of cynics and skeptics in the medical world that ME/CFS is real and common and important and deserves a lot of attention for the in the medical research world. So Bruce Patterson has an ongoing study. He keeps adding. I have one patient who's actually in his study, very smart young scientist. And Patterson chose a very, very radically different approach to treatment. He's using Maraviroc, which was originally developed for HIV, but Patterson knows that world very well. So he understood the mechanism of action. And based on their research, long haul COVID, it looked like it would work on the immune inflammatory response. And also interesting, he uses Maraviroc with pravastatin. Pravastatin was one of the original statin drugs. One of the things I tell people is that most people think that statins reduce cardiovascular risk, and I know people in the natural world are very hostile against statins, but you know, there's the medical world that loves them and the natural world that hates them, and then there's me in the middle trying to sort it all out. But statins do reduce the risk of heart attack by 30 to 40%. Now that's a manipulation of the statistics, but that is true. It's been shown over and over and over again. Statins do not reduce the risk of heart attack because of their cholesterol lowering properties. They do lower cholesterol, but the primary benefit is almost certainly the immune modulatory anti-inflammatory benefits of the statins, which I'm sure Patterson knows very well. So he puts it in part of his regimen. He's also doing very well. He's also showing very good success. He noticed that that people had a much faster response. They improved more quickly if they had been immunized. So again, another controversial subject, but you know, and not to say that this alone says people should be immunized, but it was just an interesting byproduct of his work. One thing, just to go back for 1 second to Pretorius's work, which I wish I put in the slide, is I think it was either the number one predictor or definitely one of the most important predictors of who would get long haul COVID was people that had important variants of the C677T variant of MTHFR. I'm sure that many in the group have heard of MTHFR. It's been around for a while. Yet another issue that traditional medicine doesn't really care about. If anything, the functional integrative naturopathic world maybe cares too much about it in certain situations, tends to exaggerate the importance. But MTHFR, the enzyme that converts B9 folate, folic acid to methylfolate within the methylation cycles. The C67T genetic variant is known to increase the risk of strokes and cardiovascular events. So that really wasn't necessarily surprising. Also, why are people who are obese, why do they have the highest risk of COVID complications? Probably because the more obesity, the more estrogen, the more tendency for blood clots. So in summary, we really need more research. We need all hands on deck. We need the smart people in the natural world. We need the smart people in the traditional world. We need funding. We need collaboration. I think we really need the holistic, broad perspective of functional medicine because it really does not make sense to take this fragmented system by system approach. And the hope is that long-haul COVID research is going to move us into a completely new era of understanding and treatment. It's very exciting. It's one of the most exciting developments. It's bizarre to say that we have a global pandemic. But I think there's a very good chance that's going to happen. I wrote this L-Dange response in there just to slip it in because that's another one. If people haven't heard of the L-Dange response, very important issue that's been researched by someone named Robert Navio out of California. Brilliant person, really complicated. But that will likely stand the test of time and will a viral triggered Cell-Dange response where people are stuck is probably part of these issues as well for the ME/CFS fibromyalgia group. Thank you very much. I will stop the share for now. Yeah.
Dr. Lenhardt, thank you so much for this presentation. You've covered a lot of information and I think we all learned a lot. And I just want to echo, after working with long haulers myself at Spalding Rehab and hearing all the research coming out, it definitely seems like there's some hope that this can inform other populations like ME/CFS and Lyme disease too.
Absolutely.